Mike, did you have something to start us off? I don't know if you
did. I didn't. Did you?
Okay.
my thoughts are current events, and this will come out in a month, so I can't.
I will start. I mean, this will be old news, kind of. But Eric, how was the rest of your South by Southwest? I saw you once, and then you were like a ghost in the wind after
yeah.
that.
So you said this isn't coming out right away, so I'm assuming you're talking about South by Southwest 2024. And it was great.
Yeah, yeah.
It was a lot of
fun.
It was so much fun. The sequel to that Nick Cage movie was even better than the first. I loved it.
I love that they premiered Steven Spielberg's West Side Story 2.
Yes. Two West, two side, three story.
Three stories.
South By was great. South By was fun. We bumped into each other very, very briefly. Was that after Everything Everywhere? I think, right? It was right at the beginning of the festival.
Yeah, that was right after Everything Everywhere. Like, we both kind of dipped out early, it seemed like, during the Q&A.
I bounced because my friends didn't make it in, actually. Their flight was delayed. Losers, absolutely. Their flight was delayed, and so they didn't make it into that one, which, I mean, like, yeah, if you weren't there 2 hours before, you weren't making it in. I wanted to go meet up with them, so I bounced a little early to go meet them for the next movie, which was Deadstream, which was also fun. So it was a good first day at the festival.
Okay. I was at that one, too. Even though
that's right. Okay, there
you
go. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I had a blast, though. How was your festival overall? It was good?
Yeah, it was great. I had a great first week. I didn't take off work for it, so kind of like the Monday to the week period where I was like kind of in and out. But the weekend was great. I had a great time.
So was that before or after you peed next to Bob Odenkirk, your interaction with Eric?
Oh, yeah, that happened right after Everything Everywhere ended. I ended up peeing right next to Bob Odenkirk.
So that was sandwiched.
washing our hands together next to each other as well. Yes, it was the movie, Bob Odenkirk, and then I saw you outside.
Nice, there you go.
But yeah, I was there I was there with a press pass. So
that's right. That's right.
Yeah.
So, Ken confirmed Trace washed his hands before you guys.
Yeah. No. Wait a second. Hold on. Oh, I was wondering why I got sick after that. Actually.
Actually, me and Bob Odenkirk like touched pinkies while we were.
I was imagining you with being like, "Hey man, I'm glad you're okay," and sort of like patting him while you're taking a piss.
They were sharing a stall, and Odenkirk's like, a sword fight!
Hey, Odenkirk. Nice cock.
Wait, did that happen?
No.
Oh, okay. I thought for a second we were getting serious.
No. I stopped for like a split second. I was like, should I say something to him? But I was like, nah. He's like using the
bathroom. Nah, fuck that. Yeah.
If you guys are in the same stalls next to each other pooping, then maybe be like...
like have a conversation.
I really like nobody.
He left. It's not him. It's somebody else. You didn't realize.
Which means you didn't
flush. Jared Leto walked in and he's like, well, it's Mr., but thank you. Please, please. Mr. Nobody is my father.
The Nobody, Mr. Nobody cinematic universe.
I like that. I'm down for that.
I was going to pitch my universe of, like, all the classic cinema characters in, like, the Dark Universe.
Oh.
Where Citizen Kane meets Michael Corleone.
Yeah, yeah. You had mentioned this on Twitter. Like, you want a bunch of, like, classic, like, film canon characters to have their own film universe.
Dark Universe.
Where, Universal like... classic actors. Like, it's not monsters.
Where are we going? We're like, Casablanca.
My wife, Annie, saw the cast, like, photo from the Dark Universe. So, you know, like, very infamous.
Oh, yeah.
And she messaged me on Twitter. She was like, why are all these actors in this picture together? What did she see
it like 10 years after the fact?
I explained like the whole like Dark Universe failure to her. And then she was like, wait, the Tom Cruise mummy movie was a Universal mummy?
And you're just like, shh, 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 just go back to sleep. Everything's fine.
It's not real.
God,
they should try to cross over that mummy and the Elizabeth Moss Invisible Man.
That's the actual beginning now, isn't it? Like, that's the new beginning.
Are
of
they
this
actually
thing, I think.
Still trying?
Well, I think because Invisible Man did well, I think that they are just deciding, like, hey, that one worked, so we'll start there. I'm pretty sure. I think that was the case.
Well, because, like, Wolfman is coming, right? Like, the Ryan Gosling Wolfman is happening.
But the thing is, that's also Blumhouse, is it not? Like, I think Blumhouse is sort of, like, restarting everything.
Okay, yeah.
But
so
you know what I'll
say? It's a
little
bit of a different thing.
They're doing it smart, though, by having them just individual. We're just speculating that they're going to do that, but, like, yeah, you shouldn't do that out of the gate, obviously. You know, just... make some good movies, and then if it works out, then cross them over. That's it.
I haven't seen The Mummy, but I'm pretty sure there's, like, a part where they go into, like, a room where there's a shelf of, like, there's Frankenstein's bolts. And there's the mummy's
wrath. All the characters are already dead. They're all gone.
Are those Dracula's teeth?
You damn right. They actually did put, by the way, in that movie, the best part of the whole movie, in my opinion, was the Jekyll and Hyde scene. I don't know if you guys, you didn't see it, but did Trace, did you see it or no?
I saw it, but, like, I blacked it out mostly. But I think vaguely remember
that what
was
the that was
about.
The scene with what's his face?
With Russell Crowe.
Russell
right?
Crowe.
Russell Crowe. He played Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, and that was the best scene in the whole movie.
Yeah, I do remember this. Also, I was gonna say if they got to the Johnny Depp Invisible Man movie, there definitely would have been a reveal in that movie that he was in The Mummy somewhere.
Or like, I thought you were gonna say that he was played by Colin Farrell or something.
Fantastic Beasts 3 out now.
God, is it out now? No. Oh no! Actually, yes, it is. When this podcast is out, the movie is out in theaters. It's been out for weeks.
It's getting rave reviews. It's
absolutely
taking the box office by storm.
Kicked Spider-Man's ass.
Ezra Miller's apology was really impactful.
I was gonna say Ezra Miller draws them in. Everybody was wanting to see it for Ezra.
Yeah, exactly.
A movie laced in controversy.
God, how about an entire studio laced in controversy? He's in two of their big franchises. Christ.
Yeah,
people keep talking about that Ezra Miller thing, and they're talking only about The Flash, and I'm like, are y'all forgetting that literally he's in the WB's other biggest franchise right now?
Well, like, I had this, like, thought about that franchise, right? I was like, does anyone care about that right now? Because, like, I didn't remember that Ezra Miller was in those movies.
Well, keep in mind, also, we are people that like talking about movies and stuff. The 99% of people that are going to see either of these movies, Harry Potter or The Flash, don't even know who Ezra Miller is. Even after they watch the movie, they do not know who he is. Or who they are, excuse me. Do not know who they are. And so I don't think that this is as big of a deal as, like, we are all sitting there like, what's going to happen? But, like, no one knows or cares. No one cares. Yeah. It's true.
I feel, like, so disconnected from, like what the popular culture, like, likes sometimes. Like,
yeah.
And I think I still continue to underestimate just how popular the Harry Potter franchise is, like, day-to-day.
Because the fact that I don't care is irrelevant if people like to go see them.
Did the last one do well?
I was just going to ask the same thing. Are they doing well, these movies?
I don't know what the box office numbers for this one. I saw a report and a tweet earlier that said, like, the new one is looking at breaking 50 million internationally as an opening, and that the last one opened like 50 million over that. So if those numbers are to be believed, then it seems interest is waning.
I would think so. Yeah, when Hot Topic isn't putting your shit front and center, you're dead. You're dead in the water.
Welcome to Cinema of the State, the very first Blink-182 film discussion, and why not, Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them 3 discussion podcast, now in theaters. Joining us is first-time guest Eric Striffler.
Woohoo! Yes,
Hi,
thank you for
Eric.
Having me, I'm excited.
Woo!
Welcome
I love
to
Blink-182, and I love movies, so this seems like a perfect situation.
I'm really glad that you mentioned Blink-182 on our Blink-182 podcast, because...
Somebody
very
has
helpful.
To.
A segue.
Right out of the gate, I gotta ask you, what's your history with Blink-182?
Woo!
You know what? When I was a kid, I loved Blink-182 in, like, elementary school is when I first listened to them, I want to say, because I was... You know, actually, my first... time hearing them might possibly have been from Clockstoppers, hearing
that
First Date, because I think there were at least two songs in that movie from Blink-182, at the very least First Date. And
the other one's All the Small Things.
I think they're both in it, and so...
It's at least in the trailer.
Okay, then there you go. At least that's the case. I genuinely, that is the furthest back I can think that I was aware of who Blink-182 is. I could be wrong, but I assume that that's early enough that that's probably right. And then I loved them. I definitely got them. You know, back in the day, when you'd get like one kid in class, like has a CD burner at home, they would come in and like take requests from friends. Like, you bring me a blank CD, I'll burn you an album. We're making our own now. That's what I call music freaking records. And Blink-182 was always on. Like, I always had to have a couple of Blink-182 songs on there. So, So I loved Blink since then. I kind of dropped off with them a little bit. I mean, I guess they dropped off for a bit as well. And then, I liked the comeback, you know, when I think I was in high school for that comeback. Was it Neighborhoods was the album? That was like the real comeback album.
And yeah, I'm like, I'm 2011. Yeah.
So, okay. So I was maybe a little out of high school by that point, but, I feel like that was cool. And then when Tom left and they moved on with what's his face from Alkaline Trio, is it right? No offense
Matt
to him.
Skiba.
Skiba, yeah, he seems great. I just don't remember his name.
Full offense to him.
I dropped off. Is this, so there's my offense. I dropped off of Blink. I don't know what the hell they're doing.
No,
but
I mean,
I'm glad that Mark Hoppus is doing okay. And that's really all that matters as far as current Blink to me. I'm glad he's all right. that's the main Blink news for me.
Yeah, during that period when we weren't sure about his health, we talked about it a little bit. We were very happy to see he came out okay. Not to relitigate stuff we've already talked about on the podcast, but yeah, the Matt Skiba era is not our favorite Blink era as far as music goes.
I'll relitigate something you always bring up, Trace. Eric, do you have any, like, are you excited for Tom's movie?
Say it again, am I excited for which?
Tom's movie, The Monsters of California.
Oh, is this an alien-related thing?
This is his directorial debut, my friend.
I'll watch it, I've never even heard about it. I assumed it was an alien documentary.
Oh no, this is Richard Kine, character actor, comedian Richard Kine.
You're kidding me!
Wait a minute,
well, okay, you know, you're selling me on this damn thing. I'm interested.
A full-blown narrative feature with, character actor Richard Kind. Is he the biggest name in it right now? Are there any?
That's the only, like, bit of casting news I remember seeing. And that
it's
was
a,
like,
one-man show.
2020.
Holy shit.
Hell yeah.
you actually have made me interested, and I look forward to checking it out. It's out this year?
I don't even know if they've shot a frame.
Is it like a Kickstarter or something?
It's coming.
I was going to say, do we not know if it's actually going to get made? Like, what is this?
I think it seems pretty official. Like, he seems like it is, like, it's coming, but I just don't know if they've started yet.
Because I feel like he, and I actually say this in a good way, he strikes me as the type that has a lot of ideas that he announces and then doesn't necessarily get to. That's why I'm asking for real. Like, I feel like I've heard him announce projects that I don't know that I've seen all of them come to fruition. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
A lot of them do. You turn your back for a second and the guy's got a 3-part documentary about space or something. and you're like, wait a minute, there's an Angel and Airwaves 2-hour movie? Like, what is this? So I feel like, you shouldn't put it past him, I guess, that this is going to happen.
He blew the lid open on UFOs or something. Like, he made the government release some kind of document. I don't know, whatever happened that day.
He did something. There was a video, I think.
I don't know.
It was hard to see, but he said it was something, and I believe Tom DeLonge.
I do.
A project of Tom DeLonge's that came to fruition is the Blink-182 album Dude Ranch.
Yeah.
Very true.
Yeah.
Which, this is the first song off of Dude Ranch, Pathetic. Some little fun facts about Dude Ranch. It was the final recording released on Cargo Music.
Wow.
And the last to feature their full original lineup as drummer Scott Rayner was kicked out in 1998. It was recorded over 6 weeks from December 1996 to January. So when little Michael McCabe was being scooted out of his mother in December of 1996.
Scooted out on a Razor scooter? Woo!
Hell yeah.
Yippee!
Just snapped the umbilical cord off because I was going
so
fast.
Yeah, the umbilical cord, sort of the ankle of the process. Anyone that's ever ridden a Razor scooter knows what I'm talking about.
I was still gestating. I was still being brought up.
Nice. You and your father's eyes.
Yeah. Meanwhile, Blink-182 is putting out the artistic achievement of their lifetime.
The album was released that summer, and it was a hit number 67 on the Billboard. And during that recording, Hoppus and DeLonge both lose their voices. DeLonge had to re-record many of the songs, and it also convinced Mark to quit smoking. So that's nice.
That it's got to kill them that they were that they weren't too lower on the list. It's got to kill them. them of all people, that's got to kill them.
That haunts them every single fucking day.
Why couldn't we be 69?
How do we put it out when we ranked 69?
I got it. Like, the Tom has like glasses on and he's got like a board, a little chalkboard behind him.
God, your Tom sounds British. the way you said it.
That was me being smart, Tom.
So it's like, it's gray Tom. It's like Hulk.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Eureka! I've got the idea!
I rewatched Den of Thieves today, and I don't know if either of y'all have seen that movie. But,
I don't think I have.
Well, I won't, considering there's a sequel coming out, and you might want to catch up before the sequel.
Okay.
I won't spoil the ending, but there's a point
Living
in the
Room of Thieves?
What?
That's what I was trying to think of, something like that. Yeah, that's good.
What did you? I did not hear it. What did you say?
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it.
You know what? I don't care.
Don't even worry about it.
It was for us.
I don't like being left out of
this. Well, but I like the idea of you hearing it when you listen back.
Okay. Here's the thing about Trace the Burr. He does not listen to this podcast.
Yeah, I don't listen back to the pod.
Then you'll never know.
I guess I have to.
Only the head of the editor knows.
Literally, I mean, I guess this like tangent is only for me, I guess, because it's only funny if you've seen the movie. But there's a part in the movie where O'Shea Jackson Jr. is like hiding out in London at a British bar as a bartender, and he's like putting on an English accent to work at the bar. And it's so funny because it's like the last 5 minutes of the movie and comes out of nowhere. Just
is it serious?
Yes, it's serious.
Oh my god, I thought it was like a comedy.
No, it's like he escapes to London and then like he's working at a bar and like talking to this British guy and suddenly he's like, "Oi, mate!" After the whole movie
Jesus.
Being just O'Shea Jackson Jr.
Good lord, why is he doing an Australian accent?
They wouldn't hire an American.
Jump on the Bobby. What do you think you are?
One final fact about the album is that Scott Rayner, before he was booted from the band, he gets injured at a party and I guess broke his legs or something, and he had to play the drums in a wheelchair.
That's badass.
That's crazy.
Fuck yeah.
That makes me think that the album should have been called like Wheelchair or something. Doesn't that feel like a good like album like image as well? Like, how bizarre. Yeah.
That is, I mean, yeah, well, a... I feel like some groups might not take kindly to.
but he was in a wheelchair.
I know, but he wasn't a permanent. Like, he was only temporarily in the wheelchair.
Well, if you think about it, everybody's only temporarily in a wheelchair, and then we meet God.
And the...
some activist group just so mad.
There are no wheelchairs in heaven, and you can quote me on that. There is no handicapped access ramp through the pearly gates.
No,
okay?
God, actually, he tells you that the wheelchair is an important part of who you are, and so you have to get the wheelchair.
It merges with your body.
It becomes, like, skin, leather, and, like...
I am become wheelchair.
I thought it was gonna be, like, anytime, like, somebody, like, in a wheelchair comes to heaven, and God's like,
No, the wheelchair ramp goes straight to hell, sweetheart.
He starts pointing down. He's like,
have fun.
He becomes like an Italian bouncer. He's like, yep, 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 yep.
Yeah, because that's the thing is, like, the last little leg of the wheelchair ramp goes, like, up through the pearly gates, but as soon as you get on it, you start rolling backwards. Anyway, there goes the half your audience, probably. Sorry.
Oh, this is just the top of the roller coaster.
My wheelchair audience.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, man.
So, Pathetic, the first track on Blink-182's Dude Ranch.
Wait, I have a question.
What?
Do either of y'all like Dude Ranch in particular? Do y'all have...
I love Dude Ranch.
With Dude Ranch?
Not specifically. I was going to say, let me bring it up again. I have it right here. I mean, what? Obviously, Damn It is one of the greatest songs that Blink ever did. But, like, if you were to have me guess, like, what album that's from, I would have guessed it was from a different album, because it's, like, the standout, for me, at least.
It kind of transcends the rest of the track list as far as, like, kind of core Blink songs that make its way past just being a deep cut.
The other ones, like, they're all fun and good and whatever, but it's like, that's the only one that is in the, that's a probably like top 10 Blink song, and the rest of them are not. No offense to it, but...
I've never seen Blink-182 live, but I did see Jeff Rosenstock live, and he covered Damn It one time. So that was fun for me.
Okay, so here's... Actually, you know what? You just made a good point, though. If you were to see Blink-182 live, Damn It is the only song from this album that they would play, without question.
Yeah.
There's no question. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, yeah.
Like...
Yeah, but I would be happy to hear...
Pathetic?
I mean, not really, but I would be happy to hear, like, A New Hope, because it's just a song about how he wants to fuck Princess Leia, which is nice.
That's
also,
yeah,
if they started playing Pathetic, the whole audience would have to pull out red noses, right? In honor of the Patch Adams crossover.
You know, we were talking about Bob Odenkirk before, and the guy who wrote
Don't say it yet, because I'm going to bring that up.
Okay. Oh, I don't even know what this is.
Yeah, don't... Okay, good. I was going to say, if you guys weren't paying attention, this is something I'm going to bring up. Don't look it up. Okay. Don't do anything. Okay. I knew when you said Bob Odenkirk before and nobody else said anything, I was like, they don't even know.
I literally don't know.
Good.
Mike
did. I have notes.
I wasn't paying attention.
I took notes. Let me go to my notes, too. Look at this. I got notes. I got real notes.
Holy shit.
Much like Adam McKay would say, don't look up Patch Adams until we start talking about it.
Exactly.
Much like Amy Schumer would say, don't look down the barrel of Adam...
But we're Bob slapping people at the Oscars!
Jesus, I saw that, yeah.
Funny, that's a funny joke.
It was a month ago.
Yeah, it was a long time ago at this point, but it's...
You don't edit these, do you?
I mean, I do, but I also, like... I think it's implied that they're always...
The chaos, yeah, and also the chaos of it.
It's not past me that I'm probably going to still be talking about, like, the Chris Rock thing, like, a month from now.
Yeah. It is funny, by the way, that we were talking about, like, the fact that it's a very loose connection, of course, Pathetic and Patch Adams, because I did email, Trace, I emailed you and I was like, hey, did you get this wrong?
Yeah, Eric thought there was some kind of mistake.
Because I was like, this has nothing to do with Patch Adams. I literally emailed you, and I was like, hold on, I want to make sure I'm getting this right. And you were like, oh no, it doesn't fucking matter.
Did you think, like, the song had to have some kind of thematic connection to Patch Adams?
No.
That the titles were supposed to be the same, and just, like, the titles weren't the same.
What happened was, you got the title wrong. You said it was called Patch. You didn't say it was called Pathetic. The title of the song. And so that's why I looked and I was like, wait a minute, it's not called Patch. I thought that, like, it had to at least be Patch. Like, I thought that had to be the connection. But no, then you said it like, literally doesn't matter. And I was like, all right, then we're golden.
Okay, yeah. That I didn't realize that I had accidentally typed Patch instead of
Pathetic. Yeah, you go back and look. You literally said, we're going to do the song Patch.
Man,
incredible if they had a Patch Adams song. Wait, they do have Adams song. Hold on. Why didn't we do Adams
Patch song? Patch Adams song!
Hold on. Wait a minute. We could have done Patch Adams song.
Fuck.
Man, now I'm just thinking about Patch Adams song. I can't believe Weird Al's never tackled that.
That seems like such a golden opportunity.
That
is
feels like
fruit,
such
I feel like.
A golden opportunity.
We just, like, stumbled upon
it. He wears a red nose.
What is also, isn't there a lyric in that? Literally, like, oh yeah, I laughed the loudest who'd have known. It's literally Patch Adams.
My girlfriend's murdered.
Oh,
by
God.
Our patient.
Please tell Patch this is not his fault, even though it is. We'll get into that. I've got notes.
I can't.
Oh, boy.
I can't.
Okay.
We gotta get through the song, because I want to talk about Patch Adams. I don't care about this song.
I have Pathetic? I have no notes for Pat for the song. I only have notes for Patch Adams.
Okay, so my only thought about Pathetic is that I think they sound good together, but I can't really tell you what the lyrics are, except for now that I have them pulled up
for the first time.
Yeah, I'll say I like the song. Like, it's a good opener. It's definitely, I think it's stronger than, like, most anything off of Cheshire Cat, which we just finished doing. And also, like, probably the strongest, like, overall that we've heard in a while, considering before that we were doing Matt Skiba era.
Okay, first fair. Time so, they're together, I feel like, in this, like, older era. Like, yeah, there wasn't a lot of Tom and Mark songs.
The first time they're exchanging lyrics. Yeah, I like the trade-off between the lyrics. I will say, when you mentioned that Tom had to re-record his vocals, I was listening to this. I was like, Tom sounds, like, sick.
Yeah, like, I was going to say, he does. He sounds like he's, like, 12 years old. It sounds so weird.
His voice already is kind of, like especially in Cheshire Cat, like, already, like, obviously, like, kind of raspy and, you know, high-pitched. But here, it sounds like he's, like, losing his voice. Like, it's interesting that they, like, had to, like, leave it like this. I wonder if they, like, I don't know. I wonder if they would have redone it if they could. To get his voice sounding a little better.
They did.
I don't mind it. I know they redid it, but it seems like he was still like struggling with something in his voice. But that was like really my one big standout. So like for, I'm sure what will be a recurring theme across Dude Ranch is Tom's voice sounding like, like literally like he's losing his voice.
I do like you said though, I do like the overlap of their vocals. Like, I like the end of the part in the chorus where, what is it? Well, I'm the same and I'm wrong. Like that, like the way that almost is, you're reading the lyrics and you're listening to the song, which of course I did. I was like, he's not going to have enough time to say that line. And then like he put it in there just at the last second and it was cool how it like went into back over
that
to
motherfucker.
Mark. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's like an exciting roller coaster in that regard. Like, how are they going to squeeze this in?
And Hoppus has a lot more like edge in his voice than he usually does, I feel like, on this.
Yeah.
Which he sounds good.
Yeah, he sounds good. I mean, he mostly still just sounds like Mark Coppice to me. But he definitely.
But I feel
sounds
like
better.
He doesn't like. He has like in his voice on this.
little gravel.
Yeah.
He's doing putting a little Batman in there.
He is incredibly consistent. He's how old is he? He sounds exactly the same. He has not changed at all. Mark Coppice. Yeah. Jesus.
I definitely think he sounds like this is where he starts sounding like. Good on the album as opposed to Cheshire Cat, which I noted on a few songs, or we noted that he sounded like kind of not confident in his voice. But here he sounds like this sounds like Mark Hoppus. Like this is what I expect when I put on a Mark Hoppus Blink 182 song. I'll also say that I really appreciate Scott Rayner's drums, honestly, and like opposition to Travis's drumming style. Travis is just so flashy. And, like, I think, I mean, we have a future episode that we've already recorded with a guest that kind of brings this up, that, like, Travis kind of brings something different to the band than what they were to begin with Scott Rayner.
Like, Scott Rayner is the same level of musical talent as Mark and Tom.
Yeah.
That's interesting, yeah. And Travis,
well,
what,
Travis
is, like,
Barker
really skyrockets
is like,
over them?
Yeah, yeah, he's like a drumming superhero, and then he's, like, in this, like, this shitty pop punk band.
I'm pretty sure Travis Barker is in every band now. Have you noticed that? I think he's in every single band now.
Yes.
He literally played at the Oscars and the Grammys last month, wink wink. Or I guess it was last month, actually, really, technically. A month ago, I should say. He played there, and then my mom was watching the Grammys, and I was like, I was watching like some of the performances with her, and I was like, "Who is that playing? Oh, is that him? It's him again in the background." It was very odd.
That guy with the head tattoos is everywhere. Now a Kardashian.
Oh yeah, he took her name.
Go Travis.
Travis Barker - Kardashian.
Yeah, Travis Kardashian.
Travis Dashian. Okay.
I was trying to think of something.
Wait. Bark Kardashian.
There's that. Or what about Cardarvis? Cardavis?
I don't know. I don't know if that's the one.
Okay, well.
I don't know if that's the one.
Well, like, Cord Travis.
Yep.
KourtRavis. B. Eric, do you have the lyrics pulled up by any chance?
Do I have them? Yeah, I have them right here.
Would you mind reading verse one?
Yes. Ready?
I'm ready.
I know I'm pathetic. I knew when she said it. A loser, a bum's what she called me when I drove her home. I don't remember how it goes exactly.
Oh, yeah, so, I don't remember. I don't
like,
remember the
how
melody.
Does that fit? There's no more... Wait, I want to make sure I remember where this actually ends. And go, okay, okay. There's no more waiting, and sure no more wasting. I've done all I can, but she still wants to be left alone. Do we count the next part as the verse or no? Probably not.
Do we? The next part's like... Is that the pre-chorus?
That's a little bit of a pre-chorus. Oh.
Yeah, I'll take the pre-chorus when we finish talking about it.
Don't worry.
Don't worry. I got this.
This is, I would say this is quintessential Blink-182. Like, we're treading familiar territory with these lyrics.
Oh, yeah.
Well, we've always said their songs are always going to be about a girl.
Yeah.
Yeah, like.
That's their bread and
butter.
Also
about what a fucking loser I am kind of deal.
Or those two mixed together. Yeah. Yeah, that's kind of their MO. And, like, I mean, according to someone wrote the about section for this song. And on the Genius website, which we use to read the lyrics. And they said, "Pathetic is the first track on Blink-182's second studio album, Dude Ranch. The song's lyrics describe how the band members are romantically inept and, simply put, pathetic. But even though they
wow, what a fucking, what a reach!
but even though they recognize how big of losers they are, they really couldn't care less. So wow. This is about not giving a fuck.
It's about
Does
letting
it really
your freak
say
flag
that,
fly.
Or did you add that at the end?
I added that part, but I could log into our Genius account and add that.
I really, really thought it said that as well, which would be fine.
Well, there are no annotations on this song, right?
There Nobody's are no left there on this song.
Which means we have to be the heroes. Are we allowed to even, Trace?
Oh shit! I'm on Google Chrome and not logged in to my Genius page on Google Chrome. Hold on, let me open Safari. Oh shit!
So Eric, if you haven't heard us do this before, we like to give our own little annotations. We get a lot of downvotes, typically.
Yeah.
I actually don't know. I listened before, and I don't know if I remember this part. Do you do it every episode? Because I don't remember this part.
Oh, not every episode. Well, sometimes we're told you are not worthy to annotate this song.
Yeah, sometimes it says you're not smart enough to annotate this song. You don't have enough IQ points.
Holy
shit. We have Damn It coming up. I imagine we're going to be told to get the fuck out of here when we try to do that.
Yeah, but this song, nobody's watching this song.
This song has no parental guidance. No.
Yeah, there's some songs that kind of fly under the radar, but still, it seems that we will get downvotes from people saying, you know, the annotations are, you know,
not
irrelevant,
relevant,
not right, no, you know, anything along those lines. Oh my god, yeah. I'm not logged in on Safari either. Holy shit!
God, Trace, why do you even care?
You might have been booted off the website, in fairness.
Okay. This is not gonna work around this time. My computer's being unresponsive and I'm not logged in.
A shame.
But I'll keep trying. keep reading the lyrics.
Yeah, you taking the pre-chorus?
Yeah, I have nothing really to say about the verse, yeah. I gotta say.
No, it's just, all there is to say is that it's just, like, typical, of course. It's classic.
She wants to be left alone. Yeah, come on. Leave her alone.
Yeah.
come on, man.
She's probably texting another guy, Mark.
But also, a loser, a bum, is what she called me when I drove her home from where? What, the date went terribly? What happened?
Ooh. Where did
she
they go?
She agreed to go out with him. What could have possibly happened on the date that made her think he's a loser and a bum?
Mark probably told her about his band.
That might be, yeah. Jesus.
Oh,
that's all I got.
Okay.
Yeah, Trace, you're lucky you got into this business with a lady in your life already, because, like, you can't really say my podcast.
Oh, no. I would have been booted out of the restaurant doors immediately. She'd been calling an Uber home.
Can't be putting my podcast in your Tinder bio.
I'm logged in to the Genius page. And I'm allowed to annotate, it seems.
Nice.
Interesting, interesting. a loser, a bum, she called... Oh, yeah, annotate that second line and say, wonder how that date went.
All right, I will write that.
Yeah, she agreed to go out with him.
So the pre-chorus by Mark Hoppus plus Tom DeLonge in the style of Baz Luhrmann's Romeo plus Juliet. you got to help me out, and I'll try not to argue. No one likes a dropout. Mistakes are hard to undo. So
got kind of melodic at the end. Mistakes are hard to undo.
Hard to undo.
Is this about Tom dropping out of high school? Did he drop out or did he get kicked out? I don't remember.
He got kicked out, and I was under the assumption that he just went to a different school afterwards, but maybe he is a dropout, and mistakes are hard to undo. So, yeah, and Trace, let's try to get some good thumbs up and say, Tom dropped out of high school, comma, I guess.
Okay, yeah.
I guess.
Hey, question. I'll have a question. Tom dropped out of high school, I guess? Yeah. That'll
and also say, love, Trace.
Okay. Love, Trace. There we go. Save, and I got my plus five IQ points for adding the annotation.
Jesus.
It's that easy.
I want to know, I want to meet someone who, like manages a band's genius page, like, really hard and takes their IQ points very seriously. No, I got downvoted!
You, like, immediately? He sends it back to Genius to be like, well, actually, this person was doing this in jest, and he didn't actually want to downvote me. He was doing it just to hurt my IQ.
Oh, my God. I thought you already got downvoted is what happened.
I mean, that would not surprise me. I think I can
downvote who the hell else is on this page?
I can downvote my own annotation, I think. Let me try.
You should do it.
Oh, no.
It's only fair.
It lights up red, but it doesn't let me click.
It just deletes it immediately.
It's called keeping yourself humble.
I could do better than this. So yeah, then we get to the chorus.
What's the chorus, Trace?
Don't pull me down. This is where I belong. I think I'm different, but I'm the same and I'm wrong. Don't pull me down. This is where I belong. I think I'm different. This is where I belong.
That is verbatim the big speech at the end of Patch Adams.
Oh, don't pull me down. This is where I belong.
Yeah, he's like, don't kick me out of school.
Is that your Robin Williams?
Hey, hello, how are you?
I hear it. I do hear it. It's not terrible.
It's not your best impression, but
Though? It's Robin Williams doing an impression of something else.
I don't know if I can do, like, Robin Williams in Good Will Hunting, but I can do Robin Williams doing stand-up.
Yeah, exactly. Robin Williams' impression of, like, a straight man, like an everyman, just a regular guy. That's the character that's the setup for an actual character. that is what I was thinking, by the way, though. There is actually, like, you could say that chorus is you know, in line with Patch Adams' plight.
Yeah, that sounds like, yeah. Yeah. I hear it.
I'm going to spend the whole movie segment trying to perfect it.
All right, let's keep going. Eric, what's verse 2?
I think
that's the
disgusting.
Last thing we're reading, I believe.
Is that it? Because then it's the same, right? Yeah.
Yeah, we're not gonna go over everything again.
Got it. I think it's disgusting believing and trusting. If I gave a fuck, there would be nothing for me to prove. Although it's amusing, it's slightly confusing. My girlfriend got murdered by a weird guy that we tried to treat? Wow, wait a minute. This is extremely specific.
Hold on.
Although it's amusing, it's slightly confusing. I've done all I can, but her ego is still hard to move. And that also does apply, kind of.
Actually,
wait a minute. Hold on.
She wants to be a doctor. Now
I think this just speaks to, like, the universal, like, plight of Patch Adams. Like,
his
situation relates. You can find elements of him in everywhere you look. You can
everywhere you look. Yeah, but I don't know. Yeah, I really think you could, if you really wanted to, you could make a case that these lyrics do apply more to Patch Adams than you realized.
And a year before Patch Adams came out, so, like, or is it the same year? When did Patch Adams come out? 1997?
Patch Adams is 98.
So one year before Patch Adams, Blink-182 said, let's make a song about the real guy, Patch Adams.
I mean, that might have been Adam's song, technically. I know it's definitely not. I know we know who it's about, but let's you never know. Maybe it was.
Yeah, Adam Sandler.
It was about Adam Sandler, yeah.
My mama didn't want me to play football. Patch Adams.
I was about to say, how are you going to segue this one, Mike?
Yeah, here we go.
Well, I don't know. I know somebody who mentioned that Bob Odenkirk and that the writer has
yeah.
a similar name.
Well, that's not a trans. That's not a good transition.
I don't know. That's
to
my
transition from the story before the podcast really kicked into gear.
Universal Pictures presents the true story of a man
who used humor to heal pain and suffering.
Who was crazy enough to care about his patients.
Donner, party of 50?
Patch Adams starts December 25th.
Did you guys, you didn't see? This was written by Steve Odenkirk. Do you know who that is?
I don't know who that is.
Not related to Bob Odenkirk.
No, not related. Not related. Steve O. Duckirk. He is the writer, maybe director, I forget, the star of Kung Pao Enter the Fist.
Really?
He is the guy that made all those thumb movies, Thumb Wars, etc., etc.
And he's the writer of this?
He is the writer of this movie. I'm not kidding. When I saw his name go by, I was like, which, by the way, this was my first time ever watching this movie. I had never seen it before. I knew of it, but I had never seen it. So I had never seen it. This was my first time watching. So thank you, by the way, for getting me to finally watch it. Yes, yeah, Steve Odenkirk, he also wrote Bruce Almighty, Cowboys and Aliens, Ace Ventura, etc., etc. So he wrote a bunch of successful movies, but the weirdest part... Oh, yeah, that's true. I forgot. I didn't see that one either. But the
Barnyard.
Weirdest part is that he, most importantly, Kung Pao, he did direct it, yes, but he did all the Thumb Wars, the Blair Thumb, Bat Thumb, Thumbtanic, Franken Thumb, the God Thumb.
Whoa.
Yeah, he did all of those. He's like a psychopath.
This is unlocking. Like, I forgot about these thumb movies. I've never seen them, but like, I
no.
was aware
do
of
you know
them.
Where? Do you know why you're aware of them? Because you saw them in Blockbuster when you were barely making
you're
memories.
Right.
Yes,
you're right.
I know exactly how everybody knows about these from Blockbuster. No one ever touched them, but they were there.
Oh my God. What?
Yep, I'm unlocking your own memories for you.
Oh my God. Holy shit.
Yeah, so I obviously was really, like, slapped in the face right at the beginning of the movie when I saw his name go by as, like, an executive producer, and I was like, it can't be. And then it said written by, and I had to immediately pull up my phone to look real quick, and I was like, you've got to be shitting me. It's
nuts.
True. Yep.
I'm really interested in his career trajectory.
Yeah, because he's actually, I never really looked into it, but Steve Odenkirk is very successful. A lot of really, really big movies in the 2000s.
The last thing he wrote, though, was Cowboys and Aliens, except for, apparently,
it's a
Thumb
story
Wars,
credit only.
Okay. Well.
Which is, that's really funny, considering isn't it based off of a graphic novel or a comic?
Yeah, it
something?
Is.
So how did he come, why does he get a story credit? The story credit is the story. Maybe he wrote the comic.
There is a new, like, a Thumb Wars as recent as 2020, though, and it's 90 minutes
You're
long.
Shitting me. What is it called?
Thumb Wars 9, The Thighs of Skyskipper.
Oh, God almighty. What a... I just got so depressed just even thinking about that. You know they're going straight to, like, Vimeo, though. Like, they're not in theater. Well, they were never in theaters, but there's no Blockbuster anymore. There's no market for these movies anymore.
They're literally straight to Vimeo movies, yeah.
Yes.
I like some of these names. Thumb Ray, Chancellor Palpy, Toes.
Wait a minute, Thumb Ray is the name of Ray?
Yeah.
He just added Thumb on top of it?
Yeah. Just Thumb Ray. Black
you know,
man.
I feel like maybe Spy Kids took a lot of the thunder out of his whole operation.
Oh, yeah.
I'm looking at one he made. It says Thumb Debate 08 is a 6-minute parody of 2008 Obama versus McCain presidential debate.
Now I want to know, did he get a black man to play Obama's thumb? Or is it him? And I'm concerned to find out what he did.
Oh no.
Is it Blackfinger?
I was going to say it's Black Thumb. Did he do Black Thumb?
I've got a black thumb, and I'm not talking about plants.
Yeah. But that's my, yeah, right out of the gate, that's my big, one of my big notes that I had to write down, because I was really floored by that.
I really want to watch The Blair Thumb. I think that would be the first on my
I have to assume there's no way that these things are more than 10 minutes long, and yet they were in Blockbuster.
They all appear to be about half an hour.
Okay, but how is that as an individual VHS in Blockbuster?
I don't know. I have no idea.
That is insane.
They're all around 30 minutes, except for the newest one, which is 90 minutes. The thighs
of Holy shit! you know, in fairness, it probably costs him literally $0.
He probably
does do every single thumb that is white, hopefully. He probably does every single thumb, and I bet he does every single voice, and I bet he edits them. I bet he does everything.
Well, you would be wrong, actually. At least for the newest one, it has a whole cast. Like every character is a different person.
Oh, my God. I might have to watch this. What is it called again?
It's called Thumb Wars 9, The Thighs of Sky Skipper.
Okay, I see it. And I see also in 1999 he did Thumb Wars The Phantom Cuticle. This guy's a piece of shit, okay? I'm gonna
That's
say
That's not even clever. There's no
I hate
pun.
This guy. I hate this guy.
Well, he did do
this
one.
This is an anti-Steve Odenkirk podcast.
Holy shit. Phil Lamar is in the goddamn movie.
Wait.
Who does he play?
He plays Pin.
Oh, this guy. Oh, what the
hell?
Oh,
my God.
Like, he has a ton of credits. Like, why?
Yeah, he's... But you know what? I'm not surprised. He seems like the type that would do anything for, like, a friend. I'm sure they're friends. That makes sense. But I'm sorry. I'm getting us off track into a whole different movie. I will let us get back to Patch Adams. I apologize.
No, I mean, this
movie... Oh, boy. What is there to even say about Patch Adams, the 1998 biographical comedy drama directed by Tom Shadyac, the director of Bruce Almighty, Liar Liar, the Ace Ventura movies.
So Steve Odenkirk and him worked together on a lot of Jim Carrey movies in the 2000s and the 90s or whatever, clearly.
That seems to be the case, yeah.
Yes, yes. Interesting.
Yep.
Yeah, but also it says that Liar Liar was offered to Robin Williams and that he chose to not do it. And then when that made like bank, he was like, oh, I want to do that. So he was like, the next movie you make, you're mine.
And then he made Patch Adams.
And he made Patch Adams.
Now, wait, by the way, at what point do we say whether or not we like the movie?
Right now.
I liked it. I thought it was fun.
Did you?
I thought it was fun, and it made me cry.
When?
Listen, you know what? It made me cry at the beginning. That's the thing. It made me cry when he first went to the children's ward in the hospital. Because I thought that was really lovely, and the kids were all adorable, and like that was very sweet. That really is like what you think of, I assume. When you think of Patch Adams, probably the first thing that, not me because I just watched it, but like if you watched it when it came out and you haven't seen it since, if somebody said like, hey, have you seen Patch Adams? I imagine most people would go like, oh yeah, that's the guy with like the clown nose and the kids with cancer, that movie, yeah. Like that is probably the general thing you think of, and I thought that was lovely. That was a wonderful little montage. And then there's a lot of more fucked up stuff going on. But overall, Robin Williams is so good. Philip Seymour Hoffman is so good. Both, by the way, died in 2014. I thought that was an odd little tidbit. They both were in the movie together and both died in 2014.
The
Patch Adams curse, exactly. That's literally it. Actually, we know that some of the cast did survive because Monica Potter is in Saw. Here's James Wan connections. Monica Potter is in Saw. And the professor is the dad in Dead Silence. So they did live on.
Can confirm some of the cast did not commit suicide.
Some of the cast did survive. I don't know. I thought everybody was really good. Like, I thought the acting was really good. I thought the general idea of it was good. And of course, I did look it up, and the guy that the actual Patch Adams thinks it's a piece of shit.
Yeah, he like hates it.
Of course he does, because they changed it to make it a movie. And normally I agree with like making a true story into like a movie, not just exactly the true story. But in this case, the one major thing, and I don't want to get ahead of myself here, so I'm saying what I thought, and then I want to hear what you guys thought. But when we get to it, the only major issue about like making up details is the Monica Potter character. That whole thing is fucking insane. But I'll save it. If we want to wait and get, that's a whole topic, I feel like, so I'll save it.
I will say, I think me and Mike did not really enjoy the movie.
Had you seen it before? Like, what's your deal? This was my very first time watching it, like, a week ago.
We had never seen it. I feel like I was not even really aware of this.
I just knew it was the Robin Williams clown movie.
When I started watching it, I was like, I know about the clown nose. That's exactly all I know. Yeah.
It's on the poster.
Yep.
I feel like I've heard about this movie, like, in passing before, but, like, I knew nothing about it. Like, I couldn't even... If someone said Patch Adams, I would have no idea what it was. But, like, I don't know. It started out okay, and, like, obviously, like, I love Robin Williams. But then just, like, the more it goes on, like, the more and more just, like, artificially, like, emotional it is.
Look, I'll agree with you on that. Yes, it's very, very... I chalked it up to the 90s, though, a little bit. I feel like it takes place... You know, it feels very 90s in that regard. But yes, I'll give you that, for sure.
That is, like, my big thing with it, is that it is, like, so overly, like, movie saccharine. Like, it is so...
Manipulative.
Your heartstrings type of
deal. Yes.
And just, like, as it goes on, just gets more and more ridiculous in that regard. Which, like, in a way is, like, it's entertaining because I found it so, like, funny and ridiculous. But I did not think it was very good.
Well, and you know, also, a lot of it, you could tell a good amount of it was just like, okay, Robin Williams, do whatever the fuck you want, we're rolling. Like... There's, like, a lot of parts where they just let him do his thing, which maybe that's actually the better parts of the movie, when he can just do whatever the hell he wants.
See, like, the thing is I love, like, obviously I love Robin Williams, but even in this movie, he was, like, kind of grating on me in some scenes, just because the whole idea of Patch Adams, like, was, like, making me pissed off.
The idea of the man
Patch Adams as a figure.
Yeah.
I was like, these people are trying to do their jobs, Patch Adams, and you are causing a ruckus.
That is true, yes. There's more things to say about that for sure, yeah.
Trace was watching the movie and was like, this Dean guy's the protagonist.
I agree with
Philip Seymour Hoffman's character is the protagonist, yeah. He's just trying to study and do his thing. Fucking poor Monica Potter, let's do broad stuff now, I guess, and I'll save that specific thing. There's a lot to say about the Monica Potter thing.
Philip Seymour Hoffman is the Cameron to Patch Adams Ferris Bueller.
It's all taking place in his head, yeah.
Mike, I believe you felt similar to me about, like, the broad strokes of the movie in that regard.
Yeah, it's so, like, fake. Like, it seems like, I bet Tom Shadyac, is it Shadyac?
I don't know how to pronounce
S-H-A-D-Y-A-C.
Yeah, I was thinking the same way, yeah, Shadyac.
Hasn't really made a movie. He made, like, one movie in 2018 that was, like, a biographical sports drama, which, like, his career is really weird. That he's gone. That he's done, like, Nutty Professor.
He had a big 2000s. He had quite a decade.
Well, he made Bruce and Evan Almighty.
Oh, that was the turn. I guess, actually, you know what? 95 to 2005 was his golden window. There you go.
Yeah, right there.
Greatest 10 years ever.
Yeah.
Well, it says that in 2007, he suffered a post-concussion syndrome after a bicycle accident in Virginia and experienced a prolonged period of acute headaches and hypersensitivity to light. And oh, he became Chuck McGill.
Wait a minute, that was in what year, 2007?
Yeah, the same year as Evan Almighty.
Oh, I was just gonna say, let me guess. When did Evan Almighty come out?
But I don't know if this is post or after, but... He has, like, a long personal life section of his Wikipedia that's just mostly about his bike accident.
Oh, God. Oh, jeez, Tom.
Oh, man. The career he could have had.
Well,
holy shit.
So... But yeah, I bet, like, he was making this movie and was like, I'm getting nominated for Best Director.
Did this get nominated for things? Like, because is it...
No, it has a 20% something, I feel like. 22%.
Wow. In my mind, this is, like, Oscar bait that would have worked in the 90s is what it feels like.
It feels that way in retrospect, but, like, contemporary reviews of it were very harsh on it. I read a review from Roger Ebert, and he fucking, like, destroyed it. They went to town on him. He hated it.
1.5 out of 4. Wow, Roger.
Jesus. The way that I log things on Letterboxd is I just do it binary. I don't give anything a star rating because I just don't. I can't keep up with my own ratings. Like I would be like, I would be constantly like, oh wait, but this was better than that, but it doesn't make sense with that. I feel like I would lose my mind. That's just a me thing. But all I do is binary. I do a heart or no heart. Liked it, didn't like it. And this got a heart from me. It doesn't mean that it's like one of my favorites when I put a heart on it. It's just like, I enjoyed it. Like I for whatever, 2 hours or whatever, it had a good enough time that I gave it a heart.
Yeah, I've thought about doing.
Oh, Eric, just you wait. You're gonna have to give a numerical.
Oh, you do have to give a score for this movie.
Oh God. Okay. Fair.
But not something I'll do right now.
I'll think about it. Yeah, I'll think about it.
All right. Yeah, think real hard about what score you want it to be between 1 and 10.
You know, I think the thing
is, and then multiply it.
I think it might just be that I related more than you guys to being an insufferable clown. Because
that's my life.
But I'm just saying, like, I watched it and I was like, oh yeah, I get it. A guy that thinks he's hilarious that's just pissing off everyone around him, I get it. I get it. And I relate. I was the kid growing up where, when April Fool's Day was coming up, I would have my, my parents pick me up, like, from, like, on their way home from work. I'd be like, can you check into the, you know, whatever, the dollar store and see what kind of tricks and pranks they have? And they would bring me back, like, a couple of whoopee cushions, couple of, like, poppers and whatever, stink bombs. I had my entire school evacuated because of a stink bomb when I was a kid. It stunk so bad they thought it was chemical warfare. They didn't know what was going on, and I literally got the entire school evacuated. So point is, I could relate to the character quite a bit, for better or worse. Oh, and I
you
also
were the
did,
Patch
I,
Adams of your school.
I got one of my girlfriends murdered too, so I feel like that also I relate to that.
That was one of your high school prank videos.
That was actually one of my earliest videos, was getting my girlfriend murdered. Emotional.
I mean,
like, thumbnail you really close up with, like, tear.
And me pointing at, like, her grave.
We can start talking about this now.
I'm fine
with jumping around the plot of this
movie.
Well,
I think we have to, like, just establish he has a love interest in the movie.
Correct.
Who does not exist.
Wait a minute. Let's be clear. He does not have a love... To say he has a love interest implies that she is interested in loving him. She has a love interest. If you want to look at it
that
way.
He's the one who's interested. He's the one who is in love and interested.
That's what I'm saying. So it kind of feels like he is the love interest of her almost. I don't know. Maybe I'm thinking of the wording backwards here. But you know what I mean? Like, she is not... It's not. I feel like being a love interest can be a two-way street. This is not a two-way street.
It's very much a, like, 1960s style of, like, wear her down until she says, like, fine, I'll go out with you. Like,
yeah.
Like Ryan Gosling in The Notebook.
He literally says to her at one point, you're not polite, you're rude. Sometimes you're downright bitchy. And she, falls in love with him?
Literally calls her a bitch to her face.
Because she can.
Yeah, well,
she's allowed
actually,
to.
You know what's funny?
She doesn't exist. There's no consequences.
Well, there's that. That's true. There are no consequences. Someone died in his life, but it was not a love interest of his. But the funny thing is, when we first got introduced to that character and he introduced himself, she right out of the gate tells him, look, what does she say? She says, like, I'm gay, I'm married, take your pick for excuses, but I'm not interested. Like, she said, like, I thought that was a great, like, response, actually, a well-written response. And I thought to myself, oh, this is going to be great. I thought she was going to be, like, a typical love interest kind of situation. Love interest, if she was interested thing. I thought she was going to be a typical love interest situation. And then I'm like, oh, no, she's not interested. And then it wound up becoming that anyway. So I was a little disappointed in that.
Yeah.
I feel like you could cut
that
whole character.
But then it goes away for the last... Yeah.
Yeah, she literally goes away.
She goes far, far away.
She goes far, far away, and like Thumb Wars, in a thumb far, far away. But she... The thing is, she is a like, all of a sudden her character becomes a fucking idiot and goes to this guy's, like, Dracula mansion alone, who she just said was a weirdo. Like, it was that was insane, and the whole character should have been cut. It was completely irrelevant to anything.
Yeah, completely insane. And, I mean, Mike, who is the, I know you were the one who initially told me about who this character is. Who is the real-life analog to this character?
Yeah, you look up, I believe it was on the IMDb trivia, I read it, that Patch Adams did not have a girlfriend who was murdered, but just, like, a friend of his. A male friend of his.
Yes!
So they just... changed the gender, made it his girlfriend just so he could have, like, a dead girlfriend to, like, avenge.
So you all say, yeah, so he could have a nice moment on a cliff with a butterfly.
She talked about being a butterfly.
She talked about that, and boys don't talk about that. That's not right. So we have to make her a girl.
And, like, so, like, and, like, this is why, along with, and I pulled this up. The real Patch Adams only agreed to the 1999
wait,
film.
Wait, that's a great Twitter. The real Patch Adams.
The real Patch Adams.
Right, I'm sorry, the real Patch Adams did what? What happened?
What did at real Patch Adams say?
Yeah.
He said he only agreed to the film of his namesake because they promised to help him build his hospital.
Yeah.
None of the profits from the film were ever given to his foundation. And the film was heavily criticized by Patch Adams himself, saying, quote, I hate that movie.
I hate that movie.
I hate that movie. So that alongside with all the shit that they changed, with they changed a bunch of stuff very drastically.
Yeah.
Like, Patch Adams was not an old guy going to college. He, like, was he was, like, 20 years old at medical school. He followed, like, a very normal career path. So, like,
well, there's a line early on where they do say that Robin Williams is playing a 19-year-old. No, I'm kidding.
Is that real? Because, like, no, I would fully believe that was something that I looked
over. The way your face fell. yeah, no, he was playing a grown man.
You don't remember when you hear, like just a narrator go, please extend your disbelief. Robin Williams is 19 years old.
Literally doing, like, Wet Hot American Summer.
yeah, they, like, obviously just needed to... do you think that this movie, like, the script was probably written and then they put Robin Williams in it, I'm assuming, right? Like, it wasn't written for Robin Williams.
I would assume.
No, but it was also... originally offered to Bill Murray, so they were still thinking, like,
whoa,
in that ballpark of older comedian.
Wow. Bill Murray, wow, Bill Murray is Patch Adams. That's like a No Way Home multiverse. we need the Patch Adams No Way Home.
The Patch Adams verse.
Because wait, what was the other one you said that wasn't there somebody else that we were that you said Jim Carrey.
Jim Carrey.
I have it. Jim Carrey's the third one, but I have it backwards. It was Robin Williams was interested in Liar Liar. That's what you said. Okay. It wasn't that Jim Carrey
was
interested in
Patch Adams.
Well,
it was that he turned down Liar Liar.
Right,
he turned down
Liar
Liar, and then when it was a hit, was like, put me in Patch.
I'll show you, Jim.
He, like, stretched his suspenders and was like, oh, let's go.
So I have to do a CG, like... deep fake Robin Williams for the No Way Home Patch Adams.
Yeah, Jesus. Well,
oh,
and Jim Carrey quit acting, right? So he's not gonna do it.
Sonic 2 is his swan song.
And if Bill Murray is the only one left, they better hurry the fuck up.
Wait, did Jim Carrey really quit acting? That's the second time I've heard someone mention this before.
He just said he was retiring, but, like, who knows what that means? Whatever.
Yeah, he says all kinds of crazy shit.
Yeah. Speaking of saying crazy shit, this movie could be in the fantasy section at Blockbuster over by Thumb Wars, because it is absolutely a fantasy that every single one of his jokes lands.
Oh, yeah.
Every single thing out of his mouth is a joke. And as an insufferable clown myself, I can tell you that, like, people are like, enough. That's fucking enough, Eric.
Well,
okay?
They try, Eric. They try to kick him out of school.
They try. Yeah, but
take
every
those bedpans off.
And then, like, when he makes a giant vagina out of the doors for the people coming to visit, like, everyone behind him is, like, starting to giggle and stuff like that. They love it!
That is so insane. How did he even do that? Like, how did he build that?
Yeah, I think that was impressive.
Like, that was very impressive craftsmanship on his part.
But
they
also,
were big.
It feels like, he spent all of his time making those giant legs and then, what, didn't decorate the inside? Because I feel like that's even more important. They're only outside for a moment.
Patch, why didn't you make a cervix?
Oh, I ran out of paper mache.
Look, I already made her ovaries. Oh.
Yeah, I don't know what character this is. Oh, it's like it's Mickey after he goes through puberty. Oh. Oh my god.
Hey, Robin. Hey, how you doing? Hey, man. So, hey, how you doing?
So yeah, this, she gets murdered. Is was,
okay?
I don't know
yeah.
If
we... So did we make? That
oh yeah.
Clear?
By the way, she gets she gets fucking killed.
She gets murdered by a patient. I guess you'd call. Well, no. They officially not a patient. What's the independent contractor version of whatever the hell they're working on there?
Yeah,
he specifically says, he goes, actually, so using his logic, she gets murdered by a doctor.
Yeah.
Because all the patients are also doctors. They teach us things or whatever the fuck he said.
It's such a quick turnaround, too. Like, I feel like I had no idea that was coming. Like, she goes to his house. And then like it cuts to the next scene and it's just Robin Williams.
Well, yeah, it happens off camera.
Well, yeah, it happens off camera, but also like just the way it cuts to the next scene and Robin Williams being called into the office, and it's like, I feel like that was the last thing I would have like expected to happen. It's like,
no,
I
agree.
At this place,
I thought that maybe they were gonna find her like tied up or something there, but that might just be because I've watched Saw too many times, so her face elicits that in me. But you know,
it's just a hostage movie.
And then like, I don't like. What is even the consequence of it? Really, like he just like I don't know. He has to learn that fucking life is still worth living, because at the beginning of the movie he's suicidal, which is why he like
right.
he admits himself and everything.
And then he goes and to so the like, cliff. Yeah.
Yeah. And so I mean I guess it like circles around, but it still just seems like it doesn't even linger on him like getting over her death for that long before it's back to, hey, you're getting kicked out of school again. We're sending you to trial. And it's just a crazy choice all around for.
Well, it really is sick that she didn't sign up for any of that shit. She really got like bullied into it by everyone around her, and she made it very clear at the beginning of the movie, I'm not gonna fuck with you. I am here to study and become a doctor. And then she literally dies.
Yeah,
that is so fucked up.
Can't be no doctor in
Patch
heaven.
Adams is still the hero.
You cannot be a doctor in heaven because there's nobody in heaven has any ailments. The wheelchairs are in hell.
I wanted to say that apparently, like, I've seen a lot of people say the real Patch Adams is, like, a maniac.
Well, he has to be!
Wait, Trace, have you seen what the real Patch Adams fucking looks like? He's terrifying.
I see this picture of him on his Wikipedia. Just an insane
looking
man.
He had a clown nose grafted to his skin permanently.
And the kids thought it was fucking funny.
It's even weirder because he decided to have it, like, put, like, his regular skin over the red nose, and now he just paints it red whenever he wants.
Here's a photo of Patch Adams being accused of letting his girlfriend die.
Oh my god.
Ooh, me? Just a photo of him in, like, a Ronald McDonald costume. But, oh no, by the way, that didn't even happen. I forgot. I literally already forgot that didn't even happen in reality.
See,
his best friend.
This is the poison of movies.
Yeah, exactly. It's propaganda.
The fake media.
This is definitely the Bohemian Rhapsody of Patch Adams movies.
Patch Adams 1997 is the Bohemian Rhapsody of Patch Adams movies.
Patch Adams like released a big statement when Robin Williams died that is on the Wikipedia.
For what
I'm so sorry for what I said about that movie.
Actually, I love that movie. And then what did he say when Philip Seymour Hoffman died? Did he make a fucking statement?
Fuck it. Fucking nothing?
Fuck.
I don't see anything.
I hated that guy. I hated that asshole.
Probably not, because Philip Seymour Hoffman was probably a fake person too.
Yeah, did Philip Seymour Hoffman's character exist? The only character that existed is Patch Adams.
I don't want to read all of this because it's very long, but I will like kind of skim through some of it. Let me hold on. The terrible news of the passing of Robin Williams reached me here today in the Peruvian Amazon late Monday night with tremendous.
Doesn't
sadness.
Sound like he's working on his hospital anyway, but.
No. Well, wait. Surrounded by over 100 friends and clowns on our annual clown trip.
It's starting to sound like a police report. I was surrounded by 100 clowns.
Wait, he's on a boat?
He's
like a clown boat?
He's clown cruise!
I'm at, like, he's, like, sitting off looking at the stars by himself, and he's just like, Patch, it's Robin.
It's, what happened? You, You don't want to know, sir. And it's a guy in a clown costume.
I don't know if he's on a boat. It just says he's in the Peruvian Amazon.
Okay, okay.
It says, on their annual clown trip, we mourn this tragic loss and continue to treasure.
Do you think they took their clown noses off in a moment of silence?
I can't deal with this.
And they're all honking their thing.
By the way, we should, yeah, we should be clear. It was incredibly sad when Robin Williams died, but the idea of 100 clown salute.
No, Eric, it's the same thing as that, like, Master of Disguise trivia about, like...
Yes, the 9/11 trivia!
About, like, the 9/11 trivia, yes. Which someone said is fake, but I still choose to believe it happened.
I believe it happened.
I absolutely believe that happened. Hold on, I still want to read some more of this. I'm skipping some of it. While watching him work on the set of the film Based on My Life, I saw that whenever there was a stressful moment, Robin would tap into his improvisation style to lighten the mood of the cast and crew. Let me see. He's just saying he's a nice guy.
Also, by the way, Patch Adams, that's the way that Patch Adams saw it, but the way that the crew saw it, they were all stressed and hungry and going on 16 hours, and Robin Williams was making jokes at them, and they fucking hated it. But Patch Adams thought it was delightful.
Yeah, he was like, lighten up, everybody.
Come on, everybody, you gotta lighten up or you're gonna fucking die. Like my friend.
Also, in March 2021, Adams announced that his left foot had been amputated in a below-the-knee amputation.
That's not funny, Patch.
It's not funny.
Why did you do that? That's not funny.
Due to
pirate clown doctor.
Oh, shit.
Apparently, it's some disease, so I guess it's not funny. Due to persistent problems from an MRSA infection.
Jesus. Well, I guess laughter didn't really work for your fucking leg, did it, buddy? Maybe doctors should be allowed to work.
Patch would want us to laugh.
Yeah, he's alive! You say that like he's dead. Patch would have wanted this.
That was insane to me when I like clicked on his Wikipedia page and didn't see a death. I was like, oh wow, this guy's alive?
That's the first thing your eyes go to, right? Is like an end date, yeah. Well, also, the first thing we all looked up, I hope, was Patch Adams' girlfriend dead. Because I was like, this is too insane. This is fucking insane. And you know what's funny? Do you ever watch a movie and it's based on a true story and you think to yourself, this is so crazy, it only works because it's a true story? You know, like that happens sometimes?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is not that. They just added something fucking insane. This is the opposite of that. Well, it only works because it's a true story. Oh, wait, no, it's not.
Honestly, it's so weird because, like, the screenwriter would be like, Steve Odekirk is probably like, well, someone in his life died, all right? Be nice.
Yeah. Come on. Don't
yeah, but
don't
not his fucking
me.
Girlfriend, dude.
Don't kill the messenger.
All I'm telling you is that Patch Adams was grieving at some point. I don't know what about.
Yeah, got a little muddy.
Honestly, the craziest part of the whole thing, honestly, is when all the kids come in at the trial at the end and, like, put on their red noses and, like, the big music swells up and he, like, wins this trial. That was, like, the craziest part of the movie for me.
That was ultimate schlock, obviously. That's, like, everything that you hated about the movie is, like, represented in that moment.
That is like a parody of an Oscar movie, of, like, what would happen.
Yes. The whole movie is a parody of an Oscar movie.
Yeah, I can see that. Like I said, I did enjoy it, but only just enough to give it a heart. Like I'm still working on my review, my grade, obviously. But I do understand what you're saying though, and I certainly could see how it's like a parody of like an Oscar bait kind of movie. It's the type of thing that it literally feels like looking back, and I still enjoyed it. Like I still had a good time with it. It genuinely feels like a movie you'd see the trailer for at the beginning of Tropic Thunder.
Father Stew?
Okay, so I texted have you seen the trailer or poster for this movie, Father Stew, Eric, starring Mark Wahlberg?
No.
Please look up the poster right now. Look up Father Stew poster. I sent this poster to Mike earlier, and he asked...
I feel like I saw a TV spot for it.
Mike asked, is this a real movie? And I said, yes. And then I followed up that text with, it looks like a fake Tropic Thunder movie.
Oh my god! Are you kidding
me? It's about Marky Mark being like a mafia guy turned priest.
Right, but this literally is the joke with, was it Robert Downey Jr. and Tobey Maguire in
yeah,
a trailer?
Like,
yeah,
it looks exactly
that
like
is,
that.
That is fucking hilarious. Well, so, but I mean, I feel you must agree, though, that this movie feels like it could have been one of those trailers,
sure.
The whole
like
movie itself.
Movie.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And it would have been the movie that, like, Ben Stiller is in. He's trying to get his Oscars and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That is so funny that you said that.
It's funny because Robin Williams doesn't need that, though, at this point in his career. Like, he's had, like, critical acclaim, like, in dramas already.
Well, I was just going to say, what's weird is that I feel like you would look back and say this is one of his top characters, movie aside. I feel like people would think of this as one of his bigger characters, Patch Adams.
I think commercially this movie, like, was well-received, so yeah. I mean, and I feel like if you read the script for it, you might think it's better than it plays in the movie, depending.
Well, I bet you that people that aren't as big into, like, movie, like, criticism and stuff like that, like, and picking apart movies, I bet the general public probably liked this movie a lot more. I don't know what the audience score is, because that's not even what I'm talking about, but, like, it probably did really well. I bet people look back on it, like, the general public probably looks back on it very fondly.
I'm sure if I asked, like, my grandma, like, if she saw Patch Adams, she'd be like, oh, I saw that movie in the theater, and I bawled my eyes out. I loved it.
Yeah,
probably
exactly.
Was so good.
Exactly. Yeah, I have a feeling it's remembered very well by the majority of people that watched it.
Yeah, no doubt. And, like, I mean, Robin Williams does bring, like, a layer of, like, authenticity to it, and Philip Seymour Hoffman. So, like,
Philip Seymour Hoffman's really good in this.
Yeah, he's great. Like, I mean, like, when isn't he? So, like, of course.
Is this, like, the first time we've ever done any of their movies, I feel like, on the show?
I think so.
I feel like we've never... It's always nice to add members to the family.
I do want to mention, by the way, I didn't, there's two other things that I wrote down that I want to make sure that I mention. I can't, but I haven't found a place to say it necessarily. I love that Robin Williams' character, well, Patch, what am I saying? The titular character. I love that Patch Adams just, on him at random, had Groucho glasses. But you know what I mean? Like, he just had them ready. He wasn't planning on using them necessarily. He just had them. I really like that. I kind of want to start doing that. And then the other thing I was going to say is, in terms of, like, outdated stuff, there was a part where, was he talking about, somebody said something like, did you hear what happened to, did you hear what happened to so-and-so? And he goes, oh, he's going to have sex change. I knew it. And I was like, what?
I think I actually, like, missed that line.
Oh, yeah, he flat out says that at some point. I don't remember what it was. And it's like, I can see Robin Williams still making that joke today, but getting canceled for it.
Oh, there's so many people, like him and George Carlin, who, like, it's probably for the better that they're not here for, like, certain waves of
culture. For certain reasons, like, yes. So, you know, obviously we'd love to still have all these guys around. But, yeah, of course, if you think about, like, so, you know, you get to go down with a career that is just great with no blemishes, really. And, you know, it might have been marred, certainly.
Yeah.
I identify as an attack helicopter, huh?
Yeah, no, absolutely. Exactly. Yeah.
The only other thing that I brought that I really wanted to add was that I went onto the Parents Guide, and I found this review from a 12-year-old kid wrote this review.
No,
at least the review says they are 12.
Okay,
and they gave it 1 star.
No,
it's
I'm shocked. Oh my god, I am not prepared. Okay.
The age of innocence is over.
This is an overly childish, badly written, sick, lying pile of vile garbage that needs to be thrown into the burning abyss known as hell.
Oh my god, along with all the wheelchairs.
I just thought that was
funny. And what, keep reading, it says, "This is I'm Patch Adams' son."
I miss my dad. Wait, no, he's still alive.
No, he's still alive.
And I wish my mom wasn't murdered.
I wish my mom wasn't murdered. If you keep scrolling even more, Odekirk replied to it. He said, fuck you.
Fuck you. Piece of shit.
Fuck you, dude.
Square the fuck up, bitch.
Oh my god. Can I ask, though, since I know you guys didn't like it, give me, aside from just Robin Williams himself, is there one thing that you remember from it? I'm curious. That was, like, your favorite bit or joke or anything like that? Like, if there was something that stood out that you even remember?
Hmm.
Because in honor like of Patch, let's find something to laugh at.
Something to laugh at.
Find something to laugh at. Talk to strangers. If you get a wrong number, talk to the guy anyway.
And die.
A part where his girlfriend gets murdered.
That brought some levity to it for you.
We already mentioned the legs, but I did think that was funny when it happened, like, because it was just like so ridiculous that like he like that as a visual joke that made me laugh. I'm trying to remember if there's any specific lines that made me laugh, because I did not write down any lines of dialogue.
I wrote down one. I thought it was really funny. I thought it was extremely fucking funny. I laughed. I immediately grabbed my phone to write it down because I thought it was so funny. When he's driving her to the house, when he's driving her to that, like, that shack that they wind up getting, and she says, "How long do I have to keep my eyes closed?" And he says, "Just until I open mine."
Yeah, that's funny.
That's such a fucking good joke.
I like the group therapy scene in the very beginning.
Oh, I yeah, yes.
Riffing with those guys.
With the guy with his arm up the whole time?
Yeah, kind of making fun of a guy.
No, but that was great, though. That was so funny.
It was funny.
That worked. That actually would work even today, like, in terms of, like, that's not an outdated thing, because that's, like, he's on the side of that guy. You know what I mean? Like, he's, like, so, like, that actually,
he's
that's
also
funny
a patient.
And would work. Yeah, exactly.
I mean, ultimately, I learned that laughter is the best medicine.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah, good luck with that.
Okay.
In this coronavirus era.
Don't get vaccinated. Just tell some jokes.
Just laugh.
Have a yuck. Yuck. I'm just looking at the Wikipedia page.
Do you think Patch Adams is vaccinated?
It's, of course. I can't even joke about that. It says Patch's friendship with Karen soon turns into romance when she tells him that she had been molested as a child. Patch comforts her, and I don't even remember that happening.
She's just talking about how she was hurt by men young, and I didn't understand it to mean anything about molesting, but I did see that when I looked it up after the fact, and I thought I maybe just misunderstood it, but whatever. It's
Wikipedia weirdos.
She's talking about how she's got, like, bad male figures in her life or something like that, yeah.
That sounds kind of vague.
Again, this isn't a real person.
You're right, it's not even a real person, that's correct.
They're just giving her the most tragic fucking life
ever. Most tragic past and future.
Also...
And she has to have sex with Patch Adams? Gross.
Also, Paul Adonasio? I don't know how to pronounce his last name. Worked as a script doctor for this. And he is an Academy Award nominated writer for Best Adapted Screenplay for Quiz Show and Donnie Brasco.
He worked as a script doctor on this. The irony of being the script doctor for Patch Adams is not lost on me. Patch Adams himself is the script doctor, if you think about it.
Wait, I thought Patch Adams was the doctor here. Who is this Paul guy?
That's the joke Robin makes on set.
Yeah, exactly. At the end of a 16-hour day, nobody's laughing anymore.
Patch is like... And I don't even understand why that cameraman was rolling his eyes when Robin did his, like, Burt Reynolds impression.
His hilarious Burt Reynolds impression. I think it's funny every time.
I've only heard him do it 2 times, but he's probably heard him do it every day, and it's probably just as funny.
So, yeah.
I give Patch Adams a 15 out of 182.
Nice. I give Patch Adams a 10 out of 182.
Holy shit, Jesus Christ.
I'm sorry, I can't go any higher than that, I'm sorry.
Alright, fine.
But I recognize why you enjoyed it, Eric. Like, I see it, like...
I'm gonna give it...
Are you trying to do the math, Eric?
No, I did it in my head. I give it a 100 out of 182. No, you know what? I'll give it a 99.
That's a very respectable score for Mr.
Yeah,
Patch.
Because I'm trying to equate it to almost like a half, you know, whatever. A little more than half. I was thinking of like a 3 out of 5, maybe. Because again, keep in mind, I'm thinking also... from the perspective of the general public, I guarantee it's more of a 4 or a 5 for a lot more people than you realize.
Oh, that's
like,
I really, yeah.
I bet it is. Not that I'm saying that, like, that's how I feel about it, but, like, taking into consideration that I bet a lot of people enjoy it quite a bit. And I did enjoy enough of it. It was a treat to watch Robin Williams, of course. And I got emotional at that one scene that was, like, you know, baiting me to get emotional. I would give it, so, you know, the equivalent of maybe, like, a little over 2.5, maybe up to 3 out of 5 kind of deal. So I'll give it a 99 out of 182.
I can see how that's, like, it's like a comfy movie you watch on a Sunday with your dad or your mom.
Yeah, but you turn it off before the fucking girlfriend dies, I guess.
Yeah.
It really takes a turn.
Jesus.
Next week's song is Voyeur. Voyeur.
That's right.
And we will be watching, what's it called, Chase?
Saw. The, oh man. Yeah, we're watching Saw.
It's the Monica movie... Potter-thon.
every song on this album will be matched with a Monica Potter movie.
Wow, what a treat.
No, we did the only movie that we could possibly do for the song Voyeur, which is the only movie I could seem to find with the word voyeur in it, which is the recently released The Voyeurs movie starring fucking Hollywood's sex icon right now. What's her name? I can't remember. Sydney Sweeney.
Oh, I thought you were going to say, what's Ben Affleck's chick?
Oh, Ana de Armas?
She's number
two.
Yeah,
I thought you were going to say her, actually, yeah.
They're competing for the title.
Good for them.
Sydney
and that kid from Pokemon.
Yeah, Justice Smith, Detective Pikachu, his partner.
This is such a funny idea. Remind me how long you've been doing this, because I feel like we started talking about this so long ago to try to get something going, which thank you very much for putting up with me, my delays, by the way. Thank you for still having me on. I appreciate it. But how long have you guys been doing this?
You live in a van. It's okay. I understand.
Yeah,
you're on
true.
The roof.
The end of 2019, and then something happened that gave us a reason to keep doing it.
Fair. Yeah. I will say, I feel like most podcasts last like 6 episodes, so you should be extremely proud that this has, like, it's like a real deal podcast, man.
It's honestly all Mike. Like, Mike is like the force behind it, because I'm I'm so busy all the time. I'm in school and I have a full-time job and sure. It's just all kinds of crazy shit. So if Mike wasn't around to, like, really keep it going, it would not be...
I got nothing going on.
Yeah, I feel like I think of it often, honestly, more than just, like, from the podcast itself, and more because when you log things on Letterboxd, Trace, I see that you did it for the podcast, and I'm like, oh my god, wow, Jesus Christ, there's so many of these fucking movies that you're watching for this. I love it.
Yeah.
I love it.
And sometimes they're out of order, too.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah.
Yeah.
Like, we're just going, like, watching, like, things for, like... We did one 3 months early a while ago.
Oh yeah, but we did one, like, we recorded it a few weeks ago that will not be coming out for still like a couple months yet, right? Like,
oh, I get that. Yeah. Last November, my buddy Miles and I recorded a pretty much it commentary track that's coming out in November of this year.
Oh my god.
for no reason other than while we were recording it, we just thought it would be funny to release it a year to the day for no reason. So point is, I get it. I understand.
Well, speaking of which, Eric, plug yourself and what
oh, yeah.
What you do.
Pretty much it. You can look up pretty much it. Anybody that wants to check it out, we do commentary tracks for movies and TV series, and we just try to make each other laugh and make you laugh, and it's fun.
Yay.
It's very funny.
I appreciate it.
Not to get weird on the pod, but the pretty much a commentary tracks were like a staple of my high school experience.
Oh, hell yeah. That's awesome.
Well, honestly, I don't think you can say that this podcast doesn't exist without you, Eric.
Yeah, that's
oh,
true.
Jesus.
You're the reason me and Mike and so many of these people are friends. So.
Oh my gosh. Wow. Really? Jesus. I didn't even realize that. Okay.
Mike, Emmanuel,
that's awesome.
Wyatt, all these people.
Oh, you guys, okay, see, I know that there's, like a big circle of guys that, like, keep in touch and whatever, like, over the years, but I never know who's in it, who's not. I obviously recognize both your names from over the years, but I don't know who's, like, in the circle of people that keep in touch.
Yeah.
Wow, okay, that's awesome, that's fantastic. Well, I'm glad that, really means a lot to me that like other things have sprung up from that technically. So then that's fantastic. I love it.
Yeah, we have a whole group. Like Wyatt's been on the show before a couple times. It's like, yeah, we all keep in touch still. So
beautiful, beautiful.
And if you want to keep in touch, you can follow Cinema of the State on Instagram, Cinema of State on Twitter. I am Mike McCabe Sat on anything, whatever. Google it. I don't care. Trace?
Yeah, Google Trace Sever, and you'll find something about me.
He's the only one. If you find another one, I will be shocked.
I will give you my entire life savings if you find another Trace Sever out there.
Done. Legally challenge accepted my name. Now. Yeah, exactly. Well, thank you guys for having me. I really appreciate it. Thank you for putting up with my constantly delaying this, but I was I'm very excited we got to do this. This worked out nicely. It was a good movie for this.
No, it was amazing. Amazing. This is some of the hardest I've laughed on the show, honestly. So really,
oh fuck yeah,
thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me, guys.
We'll miss you.
Bye.
Bye.